to Canaan's land. I'm on my way where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dim eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. A rose is blooming there for me where the soul never dies, and I will spend eternity where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dim eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. A love light beams across a foam where the soul never dies. It shines to light the shores of home where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dim eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. My life will end in deathless sleep where the soul never dies. And everlasting joys I'll reap where the soul never dies. Sad farewells, no tear dim eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies. I'm on my way to that fair land where the soul never dies, where there will be no parting hand and the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tear dim eyes, where all is love and the soul never dies.
I'm just a weary pilgrim, oh, plodding through this world of sin. I'm getting ready for that city, oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Hey. saints go marching in. Oh Lord, I want to be in the number when the saints go marching in. Up there I'll see on that bright eternal shore, where the saints of God shall gather and live forevermore. It's a land of love and pure delight where my possessions lie, and I'm bound for the land of Canaan when I die. Oh yes, I'm bound for the land of Canaan, and by the love and grace of God, surely I'm gaining some happy day. With all the ransomed I'll stand, singing his praises over in Canaan's happy land. Oh, a land of rest eternal, where the living waters flow, and every day I'm getting nearer to his portals, this I know. Some glad morning I'll be singing glory, glory to the Lamb, and I'm bound for the land of Canaan, yes I am. And by the love and grace of God, surely I'm gaining some happy day. With all the ransomed I'll stand, singing his praises over in Canaan's happy land. Oh, a land of rest eternal, where the living waters flow, and every day I'm getting nearer to his portals, this I know. Some glad morning I'll be singing glory, glory to the Lamb, and I'm bound for the land of Canaan, yes I am. Oh yes, I'm bound for the land of Canaan, and by the love and grace of God, surely I'm Canaan. Some happy day, with all the ransomed I'll stand, singing his praises over in Canaan's happy land. Oh yes, I'm bound for the land of Canaan, and by the love and grace of God, surely I'm gaining some happy day. With all the ransomed I'll stand, singing his praises over in Canaan's happy land.
I'm glad I know where I'm headed. I'm not just wandering around, but I've got a destination that I'm headed toward, and I'm looking forward to it one of these days. I'm glad that we can know that today. Well, it's good to have Jim and all his family, and I don't know who's singing and who's playing or what they're doing, but we're going to have them come and just mind the Lord, and they can sing, and he can preach, and when he's done, we'll be done, all right? Y'all just come mind the Lord. Anybody got a testimony while they're coming?
When my heart drinks in deep the waters sweet, and some days you may lead me through the desert, even there. treasure. So whatever comes my way, still my soul will say, I am blessed, I am blessed. Through the troubled pain and disappointment, when it seems that I have nothing left, oh, you will never leave me or forsake me. I will testify until treasure.
2020. I know you guys have heard me say it before, and I know he's probably not going to testify, and I'm probably going to get a ripping for it when I get home, but I do not want to fail to thank God for what he's brought our family through. In 2020, Preston got saved in August, and we were attending Mick and Bethany's church at the time. I'm going to go ahead and tell you a little bit about that song because it just means so, so much to me. And let me grab my thoughts really quick because we were attending Mick and Bethany's, like I said, and we came out to Mom and Dad's, and we were just out visiting, eating lunch or whatever, and then we were going to go back and go to church that night. Well, Dad and Preston were in the living room, and poor Scott and Rhonda, I hate, they probably get an earful every time we're over there because the PA and Mom and Dad's room's always blaring. But I was in there just belting it out, you know, and I was like, normally Dad comes in within like 10, 15, maybe 20 minutes of me singing, and it was like hours. hours, and I was in there by myself. And I was singing, and then I just felt like God was telling me, you know, you've been praying, but you need to get on your knees and pray again. And so I was praying in Mom and Dad's bedroom, and I love that we can pray wherever to our Lord and Savior, you know. And He hears us. He hears us, you know. It's just amazing to me that, you know, He's just an amazing God. But anyways, so I knelt down at the bed, and I was praying, and I was like, God, I don't know what it's going to take. I said, but I am willing, whatever it is, please just deal with this man's heart. Because it was hard, let me just tell you, and he will tell you. I mean, there was no getting through to him at all. And so hours went by. I felt like it was hours anyways. And Dad came in, and I was like, what were you doing? And he's like, I'm not going to talk about it. It was between me and Preston. And I'm like, fine. So I get in the car, and I'm like, what'd you guys talk about? And he's like, I just want to keep it between me and your dad. Like, it was really, you know, it was really good. And normally he'd just be like, yeah, whatever, Jim, you know. Not that he's a rude guy or anything like that, but in his head, that's what he would be like. And so anyways, we get to church, and, you know, we do congregational, and then we pray and everything, and you know, same old, same old. I'm thinking, like, you know, this is just another normal, regular church service or whatever. And Rayleigh gets up and she's saying, I gave my heart to Jesus. And Preston just started crying, and I was like, okay, God, like, you know, you're working, you know, he's crying, he doesn't do that, you know. And then Mick got up and he sang Sometimes It Takes a Mountain, and Preston was just stiff in his seat, and I didn't want to hinder whatever God was doing, you know. So I went back to the back, and Rayleigh said she had to use the bathroom, and we just sat back there, and we were just praying, and I was bawling my eyes out, just crying out to God, I don't know what you're doing. I don't know what it's going to take, but please, just save my husband. And so then Mick sang it again, and he was still just sitting there. Nothing happened, and I was like, well, okay, God, you know, we'll try next time. So we get in the car, and I told him, I said, are you okay? Because I wasn't going to ask him at church. I just, you know, I didn't want him to be upset or anything, me trying to get him to the altar. But I said, are you okay? And he said, no. He said, I'm just going to tell you what's been going on in my head today. And he said, I'm going to tell you what your dad and me were talking about. And he told me, you know, and he said, Preston, if you just have faith as small as a mustard seed, God can move your mountains. Sorry. So he said, we get to church. And he said, you know, normally I just go and I close my eyes, and, you know, he looked the part. Not that he ever, I don't know, he might have prayed sometimes or whatever, but he said, I really prayed this time. And he said, I prayed, and he said, Mick started singing the song, and he said, I've never heard this song before. He said, I don't know, you know, he's never heard it before. And he said, but the first verse of that song was word for word what I prayed to God. And he said, I don't know what's going on right now. He said, but I believe that he's real. And he said, I don't know what I have to do, but I'd like to get saved. So when we got home, we prayed on the corner of our bed. Thank God that he can hear us anywhere. But we prayed, we just sat there and we held hands and we cried together, and he got saved that night. And I never want to fail to thank God for just for his being, you know, just something that was maybe other people thought that it was small, but for me it was humongous. I was praying for years and years for him to just, you know, see God and know his existence, and just to see the changed man that he is today. I say sometimes he's a better Christian than I am. He definitely keeps me in check. But just to see God work in his life, and to see that he has complete control over him, yeah. Yeah. Is amazing. And I don't ever
berries of love that cost the life that paid my way. Death its price when it flowed down from the cross. My sins were gone, my sins forgot. There is a grave that tried to hide this precious blood that gave me life. But in 3 days he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dried for you. There is a blood that sights the blind, that heals the sick, the lonely find. It has the power to free the bound. Chains they fall upon the ground. So pour it out to cleanse my soul, and let his precious, precious glory flow.
why you ever chose me. It's always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line, with all the other not quite, with all the other get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you've been looking for all this time. 'Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. And ever since he rescued me, he gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody could have chosen. They could change the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. And ever since he rescued me, he gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood, blood, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood, blood, faithful member of the family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
'Cause I'm just nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. And ever since he rescued me, he gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus.
Thank you. took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and life has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood.
Whenever I come back, a lot of times I hear different songs and I think of my grandma. And I loved to sit over there where Kathy was. And I'd sit there and I'd look over at her, and you could tell whenever she was getting ready to take off and take a little run, she'd just be white as a sheet. And she said, whenever he comes on me, Freddie, she said, I just got to move. And it wasn't nothing about anybody seeing her. But you know, she laid down here on the corner one day, had cancer in her body, and the Lord gloriously healed her body. And she said, I'm so afraid not to mind him. And guys, if we could get back to that mindset, if we could get back to just saying, oh, if I can just satisfy him, if I can just do whatever I can to please him, I'm not going to worry about what the church thinks. I'm not going to worry about what my neighbor thinks. I'm not going to worry about anything. I just want to satisfy him. The name of this song is I Know I'll Be There. And tonight this will be the last one we sing. And that's my goal. If I don't accomplish nothing else in life, just to get there. And I'm going to have to do my dead level best. That's what it's going to take. There's nothing I can do within myself to get myself in there. Just to follow him. And I love him tonight. You ready?
Life always happens like it does. Even though I know we're only here for a while, how come it never seems like like long enough. And I don't know just when my time is coming. Still I know God has a plan for me. I don't know what leaving looks like, but I know of gold, I know I'm gonna find all the pain and suffering that comes in this life. It won't be long, we'll leave it.
Sit over there, and I decide, well, all right, if I got to testify, Doug, I love the Lord, and I'm glad I'm saved. On the way up was one part, and on the way down was the other part. But you know, I never realized, Freddie, what I was saying. I'm glad I'm saved. I'm glad I'm delivered. I'm glad I'm set free. And I love the Lord. And you know, tonight I'm just kind of waiting for the preacher to show up. I've got about three or four different messages, and I don't really know which way to go yet. And I may not preach any of them. I don't know. He may send me in another direction, up some other holler. But it didn't make any difference. You know, I want to thank the Lord for the life that he's given me. And you know, I could have turned out a lot different. I could have went in a lot of different directions. A lot of things could have happened, Tom, that the Lord had people in my life that sheltered me and brought me through and kept me from, I could have been a drug addict. And you know, we've been going and visiting with some people. And you know, there is absolutely nothing like it. And we've been in there at 7th Street, we've been having services in the summertime. We had them, they've got a shelter house.
and it's all open. And we'll set the PA up out there, and we'll have church out there. And you know those people in there, it's on the east side. And that's about the roughest part of town. But you know what? A little bit of light shines the darkest, shines the brightest in the darkest place. And you know, we started having our services out there. And as we started having them, we'd start walking around. And there were some young kids, probably in their 20s and 30s, real good kids. And I told them, I said, would you guys come over and be in our service with you? He said, I want you to know this one thing. He said, whenever you guys start your service, he said, we turn our TV off. He said, we all sit down. He said, and we all listen to every word that's being said. And he said, I'm not fit for church. He said, I'm out of place. And you know, I thought, as a sinner, whenever I came to church, you know what I felt? I felt out of place. If today, if I go in a place that Christians don't go, I feel out of place. And a lot of times, it's not the people around me or anything else. It's the Holy Spirit saying, hey, guess what? I'm trying to get a hold of you. And you know, I thought as I've been studying, and whenever the Lord brought out the children out of Egypt, he was going to deliver them. They got to the Red Sea. There was no way out, Freddie. There was no way that they could get out. And what happened? The leader followed the Lord. It spread wide open. And they walked across on dry ground. Now, what did they do? The Lord delivered a way out. But he never one time made him step one foot into the Red Sea. They were delivered whenever they said, hey, I'm going to put my faith in this one that's brought me out. They'd already seen the 10 plagues that had been there in Egypt. They'd already seen the firstborn that had been dead. And you know, today, the saddest thing is God has never changed. I remember the day that he brought deliverance unto me. He said, hey, this is what I've got. If you will take me at my word, if you will die out to yourself, if you will lay everything out, I will deliver you. But it was a choice. And you know, today in our society, it's really sad. People are making choices every day. I'll tell you about one that's probably one of my favorite ones. Because see, whenever I went over to Rocky, we went over there. And yeah, everything's been good. I've been there about 10 years. The Lord saved people. He's brought people in. He's took people out. Had one guy, he come to the altar and he said, I'm all tore up. He said, the Lord's calling me out. I said, well, good, go. I said, a lot of people sit in church all their life and they don't know what to do. I said, the Lord's telling you what to do. I said, follow him. If he tells you to come back, come back. And you know, if we will just get to work about our Father's business. And as we started going in there to 7th Street, we started walking up and down the roads. And you know what people just wanted to know? They just wanted to know that they were welcomed. One of the guys that came one morning, it was a Sunday morning. Aaron, he was up preaching and he was just about done preaching. All of a sudden, there was a big old commotion in the back of the church. Somebody was coming up the steps. You know, they got all them steps right there in the front. They were coming up the steps. I said, he's coming up the steps. He had COPD. He's got trouble breathing. He gets in there and he's in the back of the church. One of the guys there knew him. He'd been praying for him all week. He had a dream that him and his wife was going to come to the church and get saved. And he went back and he said, hey, his name's Randy Goodman. He said, hey, I had a dream about you this week. That you and your wife came to church And you give your heart to the Lord. He said, you need to go to the altar and get saved. Randy said, you're right, I do. He took off, went to the altar. We was down praying, and I was praying there beside him, and he looked over at me and he said, who are you? And I said, Jimmy Jones. And this was his words. He said, oh no, not a Jones. And I was like, what? He said, you don't understand. He said, I was coming down the road. They lived up here behind Ralph, I think. They were coming down the road. He got down to Tom's and we all played ball out there in the side yard. And he said, that day I decided I didn't want to go around the curve. I wanted to go through the yard. And he said, that's what I did. And he said, I don't know which one it was. He said, but one of them twins come and tracked me down. He said, and they were ready to take care of business. He said, they had every right. He said, I was in the wrong. He said, can you tell them that I'm sorry? I said, Randy, you get this taken care of. I said, that's been so long ago. I said, I can guarantee you they done forgot about it. And guess what? He went on. Got through. He was in such a turmoil. He got out there on the east side, left his car running, and come in the church. He was praying, and they said, hey, do you want me to go turn your car off? Do you want me to, you know, go park it somewhere? And he just parked it up there and got out and come in. Hour and a half later, the car's still running. And guess what? He said, I have got to get this taken care of. And you know, a lot of times in life, we have a lot of unfinished business that we need to get taken care of. And you know, the most important thing to him that day was not his vehicle. It wasn't whether it was going to run out of gas. It wasn't that somebody was going to take it. But he had an account that was unsettled, and he needed to get the account settled. He made up his mind. He made the choice. After that, he'd call me about once a week. Hey, Jim, I got a question. What about this scripture? What about that scripture? We'd go over. We'd sit, talk to him. His health was going down, and the thing that he wanted to do, he just wanted to get better so he could get to church. Last Wednesday, he made it to church. His wife found him 2 weeks before that. He'd had a stroke. I guess he'd come out earlier this summer. And he seen Shelly Taggart. He went and visited her. And he said, hey. He said, I just want to come and talk to you. See how you're doing. He said, I'm not going to be here long. And she said, well, Randy, are you ready to go? He said, oh, yeah. He said, I've got everything taken care of. And he said, I'm ready to go. And they found him. He was unresponsive. They took him to the hospital, put him on life support. He never regained. Now, what if he decided to say, oh, well, there'll be another day. Oh, everything will be all right. Oh, my grandma went to church. Oh, my grandpa went to church. Oh, I was brought up good. Oh, I used to sing in the choir. Oh, I used to do this. Oh, I used to do that. It's not about what you used to do. It's about what you're doing now. So, his wife called and wanted us to come in and pray. So we went in and had prayer with him. No change. She left him on there about a week. Last Wednesday night, about 4 in the afternoon, they took him off. About 2 hours later, he got to go to church. He got to make it home. And you know, in John 14, the first part of that verse, it says, you believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going to go, and I'm going to go away, and I'm going to prepare you a place. And if I go away and prepare you a place, I will come again. That where I am, there you may be also. And you go on down through there, and he's asking them, he's telling him, he said, you know the way. And he said, how do we know the way? And he told him, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes unto the Father except through me. Today there's one way. And I've got good news. I don't have a sad story to tell. I was, last year, Ruth and Enola passed away. And I got to learn so much about their life. I've never met three better people in my life that gave up everything, Freddie, that gave up having children, having husbands, having this, having that, having everything. And they're saying, hey, I'm going to give it all up. I'm going to go and do what the Lord wants me to do. Not only did they do that, but then they went into a foreign country, had to learn another language. And then on top of that, they had to go in to the government offices that were overrun by men. Okay? And then they had to get up, and women in that country are pretty much supposed to just kind of be quiet. Okay, here's three women. And what are they doing? This is what the Lord's called us to do. Adopted over 50 kids. All because the Lord said, this is what I want you to do. Freddie, I never realized how blessed I was. I got to be part of that family. A lot of them are in church. Probably half dozen or so of them are preachers. The work's still going on, Tyson. And tonight, I've been thinking about different people that's went on. And you know, one person that I really miss is your grandpa. The thing I absolutely loved about James Ray was this. He called a cat and a dog, that's just how it was. And if it didn't line up with the word, then he let you know, hey, this is how it is. I remember one time he was telling me about a guy who come in the mill over there. And what a testimony he had. He would, everybody that come in and out of there, he would talk to him and tell him about the Lord. And guys, guess what? COVID has no power over God. Okay? To him, it's just another thing. And he is still in control. But whenever he would come in over there, people would come in. He'd get to tell them about the Lord. He was telling me one day, he said, got some guy come in and ask me if smoking would send you to hell. And he said, I don't know if it'll send you to hell or not, but it'll sure make you smell like you've been there. And he had an answer. Guys, this is the whole thing. We need people that's going to stand up for the truth. We need people, because guess what? This thing's about to wrap up. And if you go into, I think it's 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I believe he's over there. I believe he's getting everything all cleaned up. Getting all the cobwebs out of the trumpet. He's getting ready to step out on the cloud. He's getting ready to come and take us home, Tyson. If you don't believe me, look at all the stuff going on in the Middle East and everything that's going on. And guys, what a hope we have tonight. Jesus Christ is coming, and I believe he's coming very soon. And the whole thing in a nutshell. Do you know that you know that you know that you're going to be there? I'm not going to get up there and he's not going to say, he wouldn't say this about my bank account anyway, but he's not going to say, oh, look at all them zeros. And then that little one at the end. But I'm not going to be judged on that. I'm not going to be judged on how fancy clothes I wore. I'm not going to be judged on how many vehicles I had in the driveway. I'm not going to be judged on any of that. The thing that I'm going to be judged on is whenever he said, hey, I told you to go and witness to this person and they died lost. Why was that? I needed you to go do this. Did you do it? Because guys, we're going to give an account for everything that we do and everything that we don't do. And the time is nearly approaching. And let us not sell ourselves short. I think everybody here is saved. But guess what? There ain't none of us that couldn't get closer. There ain't none of us that couldn't say, Lord, how many of us are sitting and saying, Lord, you need something done? Send me. Send me, Lord. Let me do it. And you know, in the line of work that I do, I meet a lot of different people, and it's given me the opportunity, Freddie. I was talking to a guy the other day, and he was wanting to work. And I asked him, I said, are you on drugs? Are you an addict? You know, it's sad, but you have to ask him. And I told him, I said, do you go to church? And he said, no. He said, I used to. He said, but I just don't feel like I fit in. And guys, let us not be, don't look on the outside. That's a soul. Jesus died for them. And let us with open arms say, come on in. Hug on them. Show them love. They're out there in this world, and everybody's turned their back on them. They feel like there's absolutely no hope. What am I going to do? Nobody wants me. I don't fit in here. I don't fit in there. I might as well just take my life and be done. You know, the thing that I learned by going into 7th Street was this, that I am a spoiled, rotten brat. The church is wonderful in there. But it opened my eyes to how blessed I was to be raised in the house I was raised. And to see somebody put their faith into action and say, hey, this is real. A lot of the people out here, they haven't had that. This is the Bible Belt. We were out witnessing to people one day, and when this guy came along, and he said, I went to church this morning, I'm under conviction. He said, would you pray with me right here, right on the sidewalk? We had prayer with him on the sidewalk. He came to church that night. Come and sat down next to me. Through the service, big old crocodile tears running down his face. And I said, hey, do you want to go? He said, you don't understand. He said, I don't know how to pray. And I said, well, do you want to go? And he said, no. He said, I'm good. The rest of the service, songs were sang, the word was preached. Big old tears. He's wiping his face. Guys, we are blessed. At the end of the service, I told him, I said, hey, if you want to go, I'll help you pray. He didn't even answer me. He took off. Had another lady there in the community. She was overwhelmed with situations in her life. She come in, went to the altar, and give it to the Lord. She's been there just about every service. Let us be about the Father's business. Whenever I tithed my time in 1998, it opened my eyes to so much. God don't need my money. He don't need me. But I need him. And he said, for 1 month, I want you to tithe your time. I was praying for about 90 people, and I'm not telling you that to brag on me. It wasn't nothing that Jimmy did. I was just being obedient. That was it. He said, you can't earnestly pray for 90 people a day. Divide it by 6. Well, guess what? I did. I started seeing people that I was praying for on the days that I was praying for them. So guess what happened? One of them, Carla, was your brother. I was out at Peebles, and I seen him out there. And I had already talked to the Lord. I had already been praying for him. And I was ready to talk to him. The sad part was this. I said, Lord, how many people did you send by my way that I was not ready? Didn't even have them on my mind. Didn't even know. Today, he said, if you'll draw nigh to me, he said, I'll draw nigh to you. And guys, we're not home yet. We've still got a work to do. We have still got a work to do. The crowd may be down tonight. One preacher, he said, but, he said, enjoy the space. He said, because whenever the Lord turns this thing around, he said, this place is going to be so packed. He said, you're going to be elbow to elbow. And you know, we got to have a vision. I believe that there's absolutely not anybody that God cannot save. And you know, as we've been in there and how God has moved, and it's nothing within ourselves. but just to be used. And the reward is seeing the lives that are changed. I'm up and down just about every one of these hollers around here delivering wood and mowing grass and everything else. You would be surprised if people just knew, hey, won't you come go to church with me? Hey, are you going through something? Hey, can I help you? Because people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. He's going to prepare us a place. You can go to Revelation chapter 21, and it'll tell you all about the New Jerusalem that's coming down. It'll tell you all about what he's got in store for us. To any of us that'll believe. Tonight this didn't go the way I thought it was going to, but I'm not going to worry about it. His word went out. He said if his word go out, it would return unto him void. Well, it would accomplish those things which it set forth to accomplish. Today is the day of salvation. Harden not your heart. Do you know today, if Jesus came, that you would make it to heaven? Do you know that you'll be there? Because everything else ain't going to matter. Guys, can you imagine whenever the trumpet sounds and we see him in the cloud, our gravitational pull is going to let go and we're going to rise. It's no longer going to take faith because our faith is it's going to be right in front of our eyes. And this life's going to be over. And we're going to be home with the Lord. What a day that will be. When my Savior I shall see. When I look up on his face. Today let us stand. I don't know that anybody needs to pray or they don't need to pray. One of the scriptures I was in this afternoon was in the 18th chapter of Luke. And the rich young ruler came to him and he said, what must I do to be saved? He said, oh, you must keep this law. You must do this. You must do this. He said, well, I've done all that since my youth. Yeah, I've always did that. It's in Matthew. It's in Mark. It's in Luke. I think it's in Luke. He told him at the end of it, he said, all this I've done. He said, well, thou lackest one thing. He said, take all that you have, sell it, and get what you give and give it to the poor. So see, by that, the thing that he lacked was obedience. The Lord said, this is what I want you to do. I want you to take all this and give it away. And you know, today I don't want to be that guy, because it said that he went away sorrowful. He came up to it. He had the choice. He could have been saved. Right? And tonight we're all going to make a choice. And if you're dealing with something tonight, I believe we're probably all Christians, but I also believe that a lot of time things get packed on. We get overwhelmed. And the Lord just wants us to come and say, hey, just let me have it. And whenever we do that, guess what happens? I've been there. I've been overwhelmed. Didn't have anywhere else to go. But whenever I came, Tyson, and the load was lifted, there was no better feeling. And tonight, if you're overwhelmed with something, God's no respecter of person. Anyone at all tonight need to pray? All righty, I will turn it back over to Tom. This was about as unorganized as it could be. But I've minded the Lord tonight. And if you hear something happen to me, I've just changed worlds. And I'm ready to go. If he takes me tonight, so be it. I have absolutely no tie to this world. I love him tonight. And I thank you for letting us come.